Dearly beloved, we are gathered here today to get through this thing called life.
Hello, and welcome to the first day of spring. My name is Jimmy Gonzalez, and I am very excited about today's episode because, well, for a while now, I've been asked a few times to talk more about the subject, but I was waiting for the right time, and what better time of year to talk about it than today? Let today be the day you hit your reset button. Today we will be talking about all things for a good spring cleaning. Now this is more than throwing some stuff out and vacuuming. And please don't let the anxiety begin to build up with the whole, "But Jimmy, I don't have time." Funny thing is, when you have wanted anything in your life, you have always made the time. So if cleaning and clearing your home, mind and body, is not important to you, that is completely understandable. Now, notice how I quickly threw in mind and body. Because realistically, when you're doing a good cleansing of your home, it affects your mind and body. So if today's topic is not for you, well, it's understandable. Maybe you could come back to it another time. Today's episode is for people that want to better themselves. You see, so many bring up the topic of nothing good happens, or I never receive any good opportunities, but everyone else does. Well, here's a tip. Get rid of clutter. And you may just find that it was blocking the doors you have been looking for. I, of course, have to add that just because you don't see the cobwebs and dust means they're not there. Remember, I now own a commercial and residential professional cleaning company. And from one week to another, I see dust build up. I see tracks of dirt and gravel build up. And if you are like me, I have cats and dogs. So you can add some extra dirtiness to your home. Well, they do. But now understand, most of you work, and I appreciate that for that, because for my business, that is job security. We work in many, many homes and quite a few offices, and stuff just gets dirty. It is completely understandable. I'm not here to judge anyone. In fact, to me, when we're cleaning a home, if you don't see the dirt and it's clean, that's when I find it kind of odd, because dust happens. But here's my mental twist. The mind is an amazing machine. It so is. I'm devoting my life to it. Your mind is always taking things in, especially those things that you do not even notice around you. But here is your wake-up call. When your room or house is messy, how does it make you feel? For most people, messiness, that's a fun word, harms their emotions, making them feel anxious and depressed. However, even though messiness can cause these negative feelings, individuals who struggle with depression may struggle to find the energy to clean their space. This is why I recommend a cleaning company, any cleaning company. Or honestly, just get some friends to come over. If you can't find the energy to get off your butt and do it, that's fine. You know what you do? You invite some friends over for a lunch date or a dinner. And then while they're there, you just do some cleaning. Now, this does not mean you have to gut your home. But, you know, once you get started, the cleaning bug bites you. And hopefully it's not the bed bug that will bite you. And you will not be able to stop, because the more you clean, the lighter you feel. Winter, for many, can be depressing. In general, we all tend to hibernate a bit, but it is getting warmer. And why was March chosen for spring cleaning? Interestingly, surprisingly, there's a reason. March was often the best time for dusting because it was getting warm enough to open your windows and doors, but not warm enough for insects to be a problem. And the breeze could carry the dust out of the house, and all of that negative energy that has been living in corners and crevices around your home that have been building up over the winter. Hopefully, you will understand this is more than just vacuuming and dusting, but it is shedding your winter blues and letting in the warmth of the sun. Stop living in darkness and allow the light and new opportunities to flow into your home. Not just today, every day. Be appreciative of the sun by welcoming it in. Before you know it, you'll be outdoors riding bikes, walking, hiking, and planting gardens and enjoying the sun. Remember that you don't know if this year will be your last. I hate to sound grim, but it is true. Live today. Live this week, this month, as if it is your last. Cherish the day. I hate to sound, you know, grim, like I said, but it's just a lot of us just let life get in the way, and then we make excuses that we're too busy. You should never be too busy to, as they say, smell the flowers. Do this, and so much about yourself will change for the better. As the author Walter Hagen best said, you're only here for a short visit. Don't hurry. Don't worry. And be sure to smell those flowers along the way. Do not let this spring quickly turn to summer and then autumn and then winter and then welcoming in 2025. Because it sounds far away. It's not. 2025 is right around the corner. Live for today. Please, I beg of you. Live for today. Do not let this spring quickly turn and just become fought next year again. And then you make excuses of why you couldn't do things. When you feel that you don't have the time, let me remind you that once you're no longer here, then time will be up. For now, get up, turn off the TV, put on some music that inspires, and just start with one pile, one box, one room. Understand this is not a race, but you have to start. You will see and feel the benefits. A clean house is a happy house. This goes for cars too. Now, for some scientific studies about the mess laying around your house. Household mess can trigger stress and anxiety. Some will disagree with this, but the brain favors order. Now, does this mean your home should be spotless? Well, no. I prefer the word lived in. I have personally been in many homes, many, many homes. And to me, a house that is perfectly clean and doesn't feel lived in, I actually find creepy. Then preferably in a lived-in home. But you see, not all clutter is bad. Occasional disorder can get some creativity going in you. But understanding its impact can lead to better mental well-being. Here are some interesting facts about clutter. A cluttered environment can lead to cognitive overload as the brain struggles to prioritize attention amidst distraction. So basically, it's just too much shit to look at. I've been in homes that, like, upon walking in, I can't take it all in. And again, that's your mess, not mine, but it's just a lot to take in. And what ends up happening is you may adapt to it and think it's okay, but your subconscious mind can be struggling. As I just said, sometimes your brain prefers some sort of order. What you see as order and what I see as order is different, so I'm not here to judge. But studies suggest that women might be more affected by clutter-induced stress than men do to societal roles and expectations. While constant disorder is unproductive, perfectionism and cleanliness, okay, can also be harmful, linked to anxiety and also poor mental health. Do you ever feel overwhelmed by the sight of clutter and mess in your home when you get home? Have you walked in the door only to feel overloaded by surfaces covered in scattered papers, unwashed dishes, and clothes in piles, or like an engine on the couch? Maybe you've even had arguments because it bothers you more than it bothers your partner or roommate. That's when it's tough, when it's someone else's mess. And then your thing is, well, I didn't make the mess, so I'm not going to pick it up. I understand, but I don't agree. But you're not alone. Many people report a messy house can trigger feelings of stress and anxiety. So why do clutter and chaos make some of us feel so overwhelmed? Well, here's what research says and what you can do about it. This is referred to as cognitive overload. When we are surrounded by distractions, our brain essentially becomes battlegrounds for attention. Everything competes for our focus. But the brain, as it turns out, prefers order and single, this is why I brought this up, it's interesting, single tasking over multitasking. Single tasking just sounds so much more relaxing, doesn't it? This is why after a long day at work, we wish to come home to peace and quiet. We may resolve one issue at hand, but when we look around at our mess and our clothes and things that need to be replaced and broken, we just drown out and go, I'd rather do nothing. Completely understandable. Balancing the weight of the world at work, trying to do our jobs, making everyone happy to make some money. So after a long day coming home, needing to disconnect makes sense. But this is why I am the one to always share the create a small task if you have to, a realistic task. Don't feel the need to come home and have to put up a fence or, you know, redo an entire room. Be realistic with yourself. You know what you can and can't do, and don't let others judge you or push you. Little by little. I'm one, I like bigger tasks, but Melissa doesn't. So she's more organized and more focused on certain things. I want to gut the entire house at once. See? So we're all different. But you want to make it easier for you. Now, there are those that will say, I am one that needs to do it all, like me. But, and like I said, I can vouch for that attitude. But the problem is a lot of people will have the idea of what they want to do, and then all of a sudden they realize that their vacuum's not working. Or, you know what, we really need a dumpster. And, you know, because the mess has been here since 2021. So what ends up happening is nothing. Nothing happens. That's why I always say try to be realistic and know yourself. Because then you will find yourself up to your eyeballs in dust, cobwebs, and piles of, I don't know what that is. And the order helps reduce the competition for our attention and reduces our mental load. While some people might be better than others at ignoring distractions, distractible environments can overload our cognitive capabilities and memory. Clutter, disorder, and mess can affect more than just your cognitive resources. They're also linked to our eating. Yes, our eating, our productivity, our mental health, and even our parenting decisions. If you do not have the time to take it on, please don't. Don't feel that because we're, you know, you're listening to me now, you're like, okay, this weekend I'm going to gut my entire house. You work, you have stuff to do, you have errands to do. Be realistic. Little by little. We will soon be selling this home. So I have been since COVID. I did big jobs first. But now I'm going through the house little by little. I don't have time. I'm working now every day. So what I'm doing is in between here and there, finding like literally a half an hour or an hour. While I'm here, usually in the morning, I just wake up and I get out and I'll paint like this wall or the staircase or the top of the staircase or this bedroom or that bed, little by little, little by little. It makes it so much easier instead of attacking it all at once. And remember, it's important. Clutter isn't all bad and we shouldn't aim for perfection. Okay, so as you know, just go through these piles. I've been in so many homes and I've seen so many homes that have these piles. And it's funny because upon me looking at it, the homeowner will automatically try to defend it. Well, you know, I've been trying to get to it in this. I'm like, you don't have to defend yourself. It's you know your schedule. You know when you can and can't get to things. And always remember that real homes don't look like the ones in magazines. So honestly, don't try. Living in constant disorder isn't productive, but striving for perfectionism and cleanliness can also be counterproductive. So crawl before you dust, mop, and vacuum everything. I want you to create a realistic habit that you can continue with. That's the thing. Not that you just go and clean everything and then you don't clean anymore for a couple years. Do this and you will keep your home cleaner always. You know what you do? Pick certain days. Like, you know, Fridays is when I do the kitchen mostly, and I clean out the refrigerator once a month or once every 2 months, and just stick to that. And, you know, if you're supposed to clean it today and you can't, well, you do it tomorrow. Don't be hard on yourself, because what ends up happening is it blows up in your face and you don't do anything. I just recently heard of something called micro-tidying. It's funny how there's just words and abbreviations for everything. Micro-tidying. If you don't have time for a complete cleanup, commit just 5 minutes to clearing one small space. I actually have a habit that whenever I'm done in the bathroom, I clean it. As I'm working my way out of the bathroom, like in the morning usually, after I'm done taking a shower, I spray some stuff in the shower, I wipe in toilet, clean the toilet, you know, replace the paper roll, wipe down the sink. It's just a habit I have now. And it works instead of waiting until it gets totally filthy and then I'm drowning. I tend to focus mostly on rooms with the most traffic. It helps because I don't then feel as if I'm drowning in kitty litter or dog fur. Now, as you listen to me about clutter and a messy home, know that if your home is a mess, this does not define whether you are a good or bad person. I just want to remind you that you deserve success, meaningful relationships, and happiness. Whether or not, you know, in your office, your home, your car is a mess, it happens. But know that that mess can and will get away from you. And once you create good habits, not only will they benefit you, but they would also benefit those you live with, especially children. My opinion, get them going young. From a very young age, they may not have to worry about cleaning the common areas of your home. But cleaning their own messes and especially their rooms will benefit them. Things happen for a reason, and as they are happening, we may not understand or agree with them. But I was forced into slave labor. Just kidding, but, you know, I was 9, and I felt like it, but my mom had a knee replacement, and my schedule was not as busy as my brother's or my father's, so I was taught to make sure she was comfortable on the couch during her, you know, healing period, which was about 2 years back then. We're talking 79. Back then, they butchered you. I mean, I had a knee operation, and the very next morning, I was forced to go up and down stairs. She actually couldn't bend her leg for about a year. And then that following year was very painful. Back then, like I said, they would butcher you to replace a knee. But it was a blessing for me in disguise because I was forced to learn how to cook and clean and still balance being a kid. I looked back all the time and think of it, and I am so grateful for the lessons and to especially be there to make her situation a little easier. This is why so many will ask me about my newest venture as a co-owner of Your Time Cleaning. I have owned many businesses, and they will always have to do something with helping others. I see the pattern, and it is very rewarding for me. But in fact, cleaning homes when I do, the dirtier house, the better. I really get so much out of it, especially cleaning out a hoarding home or getting a home ready for a new homeowner because we work with realtors. And when I say in our ads that we are good at what we do because we love what we do, I mean it. Now, here's my twist. As for the spiritual and energy flow behind all of this, there is something I have become very good at over the years, and it is feng shui. And I will get into that at the end of this. But that is a part of energy and cleansing the home. Since I was young, I could tell there was something to cleaning and then feeling after cleaning a positive flow of energy around the house. Just felt lighter, felt brighter, not just cleaner. Then one day walking through, God, I remember Waterbury Mall. I remember, God, it was like 20 years ago. And I was walking through the mall, and they had one of those Asian stores that had just opened with the most beautiful things. You know, the Buddha statues, the waterfall, and the bamboo decor. I was so enthralled by it. And you could, the way I am, I went in and I asked 101 questions, and I spent all of my money. But I kept going back because there was something more to this world. It's a past life thing for me. But about a year later, my world kind of crashed down because my mother had passed away, and it made sense that I turned to the passion for Buddhism. And this was more than just sitting around meditating, but also making my home positive. You see, it all happens for a reason. I still have my Buddhist altar, and you know, which has grown tremendously over the years, but the energy of the space has grown, and my understanding that you need a place in your home to find peace. And, you know, it's I'm blessed to have, you know, to be where I am, but I know of many people that don't have that space because they live with, you know, other people and make things difficult. So, I mean, I know of people that have special places in parks or different locations. There's temples all over the place. So for me, it's the room I'm actually speaking to in right now. Do you have a go-to place that you can run to when life kicks you in the ass? So, when you spring clean your house, you will see how you are also spring cleaning your mind. Now, as I said before, what I'm getting at is more than a great smelling home, but how does this affect your mind? When you are decluttering, I'm not saying to just throw stuff out, because that alone may keep many from beginning, because, well, I don't know what to throw out. But in this sense, you are decluttering the things that are holding you back. You're reinventing or refining your values, and then maintaining that sense of mental cleanliness and self-awareness moving forward, which will welcome so many opportunities into your life. Here are a few strategies to get started with your mental spring cleaning. So let's continue on this cleaning, but without a duster or a mop. While you are cleaning, I'm most likely looking through your past and piles of memories. This is a time to get rid of self-criticism through awareness and reframing. Yes, I'm not talking about that pile in the corner, so, you know, the stuff next to the dresser that you don't no longer even know what's even under there. But one of the biggest things that can happen is the cluttering of our minds. It holds us back, brings us negative thoughts, depression, as I said, anxiety about ourselves, and you get the feeling of drowning. So before you know it, you know, I mean, I assume you're not going to become one of the hoarders on TV, but that's how it starts. They don't just start collecting that much. It starts with a small pile, and before you know it, it's gotten away from them. And now they feel guilty and they feel like a horrible person, and they shouldn't, you know. But, you know, see, if you're going to clean this spring, start with the dirtiest part of your home, your mind, which is your mind. And allow those negative thoughts about yourself that have been keeping you down to stop. Clear them so you can start to feel better about yourself. By focusing on a new approach to how you see yourself, there will be more opportunities. And once you clean your mind of limiting beliefs, you will find that you can now open all of these doors. Well, especially since you've found the keys to them in that pile next to the dresser that you don't know what the hell it is. So, start fresh outside and especially inside. As you clean your home and your car, you will feel it become easier, and it'll help you plan ahead of what more you want to do. So again, do this in steps. It's just my opinion. These piles of whatever will no longer be able to keep you from moving forward and seeing all of the possibilities for new growth in your life. I must add that negative self-talk is, to me, the worst type of dirty. It creates a greasy, sticky grime in your mind that will make it harder for you to see your true potential. And this is exactly why I chose this topic for today. I want you to see your potential. But it must start with you taking the initiative to be willing to do the work, the physical and the mental. What will keep your mind and home spick and span clean? New habits. For many people, the hardest part about developing a new habit isn't getting started, but rather keeping it going over time. Getting up can be easier than the power to keep it going. And when it happens, this is not a time to beat yourself up when you slack off. Remember, you are human and things happen, but I usually recommend having someone you can trust to hold you accountable. A good thing, to me, it's just my opinion, is a dry erase board somewhere in the house. I mean, we just recently got a cork board on Facebook Marketplace for, I think it was like $10. They're very helpful. There's nothing wrong with keeping it written and in view. Mondays are dust days. Every third Saturday of the month, you clean out your fridge. Fridges tend to be forgotten, and on an energy level, this is where you store your food. And you should want to enjoy to open your fridge and see all of the different foods that will keep you alive and healthy, and happy. And if there are foods from 1983 and an old drip going down the back from shelf to shelf and puddling behind that jar of, I forgot what that was, this may be a time to throw out, clean up, and replace with some fresh stuff, especially like baking soda. Again, good energy from, as you notice, I'm going through your entire home. And honestly, yes, I mean, it's nice, job security, call a cleaning company, but on, you really should be involved in this. It is your home. It doesn't mean that you can't move furniture, but you can clean out your own fridge. You can throw some stuff out, and honestly, do not spray chemicals into your refrigerator. I personally, when we do it for people, I do a mix of baking soda and water lightly, and I wipe everything down, and then I dry everything off. And then I put a brand new box of baking soda. It's just my opinion. Now, speaking of energy and flow, let me introduce you, for those that have may never heard of feng shui, the easiest way to explain it, and it can get a lot more involved, trust me, there's layers to feng shui, but let's say that there was a breeze of positive energy in front of your house knocking at your door, and it really wants to come into your home. Hopefully, it can get through the front path, it can get up the steps, it can come in your front door. And it won't get entangled with broken stuff and piles of craziness in front of your home or on your front porch. For example, your home's entrance should be clear of stuff. Not so much to allow, at least to allow the Amazon delivery guy from coming in. But you want to let the flow of energy of come into your home. You want to welcome this positive energy. See everything from this point on as welcoming a breeze of energy throughout your home, okay? So you're allowing it to travel through the front door from room to room, up and down the stairs, growing more and more as it sees and feels no clutter. And no clutter is keeping it from getting through. Understand, things happen, because I've been in homes that we clean for and I've mentioned something that was wrong or broken or whatever. And the homeowner will like look at me and just say, oh my God, I didn't notice, that broke 10 years ago and I just forgot about it because life happens. But it's not good for energy flow. So like if you have broken things, you have cracked glass, old photos, dying plants, missing tiles, missing panes of glass, cracked walls, torn rugs, electronics that you no longer use, but they're just stacked in the corner because you never know. Ceiling fans that can't spin from the weight of the dust stuck to the blades. Right now, wherever you're sitting, if you have a ceiling fan in your home, look up. Again, it's something that we don't do. And I've actually like pointed it out to people and people literally like, I didn't even notice because we don't really look up, but this goes on and on and on. It doesn't help if these piles of whatever are hidden in a closet. So if you're trying to like, I'm not going to deal with them today, I'm going to hide them. Put them in a closet or under the bed or behind the furnace in the basement. Bottom line is, the out of sight, out of mind, that doesn't work. You may think it does and you may try to forget it, but you can't because the subconscious remembers that there are things that at some point in the future you're going to have to deal with. And this creates stress. And it will creep up on you and it will haunt you even though you think you don't remember. This is why after a good cleaning, people in general feel refreshed and lighter mentally and physically. When you clean, this momentum begins and what happens is truly enlightening. This train of thoughts begins to cross over, across everything, and you will begin to reevaluate everything in your home, why you do the things you do, why you collected the things you did. And this also goes to like analyzing friendships and relationships, because now you feel positive, you feel flow, you want to take over the world. And now you feel like, oh, the person you're with or your friend or whatever, they're keeping you back also. Declutter. You don't need negative people in your life. They only hold you back. Remember that what you see around your home and what you allow in your life is what energizes you or steals your magic. Now, I still have a little time and I want to introduce to you that feng shui thing I keep talking about because it's exciting. Feng shui is a traditional practice that originated in ancient China, and which it claims to use energy forces to harmonize individuals with their surrounding environment. Automatically, I know a few of you are like, what? Or, you know, that's great. No, actually, it's been used for, think of it this way, for thousands of years before you were even born. The term feng shui literally means wind and water. So it's, for example, it's fluid energy. So as I had mentioned in the beginning, the flow of energy going through your home. Or let's just say like water flowing smoothly throughout your home, cleaning and cleansing as it goes through. And it's not being forced to stop at like a pile of whatever the hell that is, or broken things or boxes you've been collecting that are gathering in the corner, just building up dust. You want everything to flow through your home smoothly and then kind of like go right out the back door. So it all begins with these five elements: earth, metal, water, wood, and fire. And how those energies translate in different parts of your home and home design and your decor choices. Then matching, because here's the part. I mean, I'm not going to get involved in this. If you want to, honestly, I'll mention again, Google it. But what you're supposed to do, step one, is see where your house stands when you compare it to a compass. Like you could just download a compass on your phone, but it's like the front door. Is it in north? Is it in south? Is it in east, southeast? Is it in northwest? Which way is it directed? Because that's where you place this idea of this compass. Because then you figure out where each room lays, which each energy lays. Is your bedroom water? Is your bedroom metal? Is the front entrance wood? Or is the living room fire? Again, I don't want to get too much into this because I'd rather keep it simple, but that's like if you happen to come across, you're like, what was he talking about? That's the big scheme of things, that you want to match the energies of the elements to where they're supposed to be placed. And then based on where they're placed, there's no right or wrong. It can get difficult because let's say, for example, you want fire in the bedroom, which we all do, but instead you have water. So that's just flow. You know, that might not be the greatest energy for a bedroom, but there's things you can do, different things you could paint, different artwork, different decor that will help battle that and fix it and just energize it. Again, there's no right or wrong, because people automatically are always questioning everything. Is it right or is it, there's no right or wrong. It's just working with the energies to enhance them. And when you do, you have better flow. So there are so many great sites explaining the positioning of your home and matching the elements. So like I said, you could Google it or you could just write to me and be like, hey, could you, you know, send me something? And I'll find something, tips and tricks or whatever, because it's, like I said, is you can keep feng shui simple or you can get like, you know, level 30. But I usually tell people the basic way to start this is when you're done listening to this, go outside. And stand in front of your home looking at the door that you go in through. And ask yourself, as you look, is the entrance to your home clear and concise? Are the numbers, you know, the address numbers, are they like falling off the front of the house? Is your mailbox on the floor? Are there old vines going across your front walkway? I mean, these are all things that are symbolic. There's obviously, as you can tell, there's a lot of common sense here. So you want there to be flow, okay? Again, remember, you're the breeze, you're the water, and you want to go into your home through your entrance and flow. Are you walking in all of a sudden there's something in your way? Is it, you know, because that's the thing. Imagine, again, as your energy and you're floating through your house and you open the front door and all of a sudden you're looking at the back of a dresser or something that's just butting you. It's just not letting you go in. That's negative energy. And there, again, doesn't mean you have to move everything or rearrange walls. Yeah, there's window placement, there's crystals. We actually live on a dead end. Oh, I'm sorry. There's a dead end in front of us. So it's like a T. And realistically, when it comes to feng shui, that's very poor qi. Qi is the energy. So I hang crystals in the front window. And I have different things that I hang in front of the house to push back that energy. So basically, like, cars constantly are coming to the, you know, across the street and they're pointing at us. In this world, it's like considered daggers of negativity. So you want to be able to block that. Can I physically move my home? No. But again, there are cheat ways. So like I said, we hang in both of the windows, the main windows and the front door. I have crystals, which you can't forget that they're there. They have to be cleansed. Again, these aren't things that you do and you set them up and then you forget about them for 6 years. No, you have to follow through. Okay, nothing here is that magic pill that, you know, I just want to do it once and it's done. No, you have to do the work, because it is through the power of your intention that you make things happen. Okay, so again, so you're walking up your front door and you can't make it. Front steps are broken, the screen door is barely hanging off and it sticks, so you can't physically open your screen door. But you know, what am I supposed to do? Get it fixed. Find somebody. Never do the whole thing that, oh, it's broken and what am I? No, figure it out. Because I have personally Googled everything you could think of when I needed to fix something that I had no idea how to do it. Okay, and you'd be surprised, not everything is replacement, or you have to, you know, do all this work. A lot of times it's like, oh, put some grease in the door, you're done. Or, you know, tighten some screws, you're done. But by saying, oh, it's just too much work, you're creating a negative entrance. And then, of course, you walk in, or not even, front lawn, there's piles of shit everywhere. Front lawn is like messy. There's, you know, a dead tree that's been there for like 3 years, and you know, I'll get to it one day. If you want to welcome abundance, you got to get to it today, or at least in the next few weeks. Remove it, clean it, clear it, get off your ass and just do some of the basic work yourself, because that's how you connect with your home. Maybe some projects have been, you know, you've been planning on getting them done since BC, before COVID. It is in these piles of never-ending projects that energy will get stuck. Now, we have finally made it in the house. Main doorway. Keep the main entryway free of clutter. I have been into many homes that you can barely get by the front door. And this always explains the energy of the dismal feeling you get when you walk in. And then the living room. The living room. Seating should be ample, facing each other with no backs to the entryway. Okay, you want to welcome. Even if you don't want people in your home, you want the feeling of being able to welcome people in your home. Because as I said, we're talking about not welcoming just people, but welcoming energy. The kitchen. The kitchen is an important part because that is where everything happens that feeds you. Maintain cleanliness for good health. Clean refrigerator, clean stovetop, not sticky tops, not dirty utensils. And to me, a big thing is the sink, but I'll get to that in a minute. You know, I understand that dishes may sit in the sink. That's fine. But sometimes, honestly, stop being lazy. You eat breakfast and then leave the house, so I get it. I have to go. Then lunch. Well, there's another dish, but I will get to it later. Then dinner. Oh, I am tired. And now your sink looks like a diner after the lunch rush. Wash your dishes. Clean your home. And if anything, people are like, oh, I hate doing dishes. Well, to me, my perspective of dirty dishes is I love doing dishes. Since I was a kid, I enjoy doing dishes. Especially if there's a window. I love to have a window in front of the sink. Because while I'm doing dishes, I'm just looking out the window. I have bird feeders all over the backyard, so I'm watching the birds. Because to me, it's symbolic that I'm washing dishes because I was able to eat. And to me, that's a blessing. Now, bathroom. Weird one. This is a habit I've had before I even knew what feng shui was. The door should always be kept closed. What? Yes. So remember the whole flow thing, the energy flowing through your house? Let's jump to the concept of water, a flow of cleaning, clear and clean water flowing through your home from the front entrance, going through, okay? Think of it as this water needs to get through and is bringing in positive energy into your home. But in your bathroom is what? The toilet. And it's symbolic that this energy will flow right into your bathroom and down into the toilet, into the sewer. So that is why it's symbolic to keep your bathroom clean and keep the door closed. Whenever I'm done using the bathroom, I immediately close the top. That's also a part of it, to not let energy disappear. You want the energy to stay in your home. Now, bedrooms. Bedrooms are important. Bedrooms are a place of peace. What do you do in your bedroom besides having sex? You sleep. Actually, hopefully you sleep more than you have sex. But it doesn't have to feel like a paradise of clouds and unicorns. But when you sleep, your chattering monkey also sleeps. And the subconscious mind does not. So this is why you may have heard me say that right before you go to bed, your last thoughts should be of the positive things that you went through throughout your day and not the things that went wrong. I mean, if you wanted to talk about those with family at dinner, that's fine. But now it's night-night time, and that means you're about to go to bed, which means your conscious mind is going to go to bed, which means your subconscious mind is going to start dreaming and start thinking of things. And if you're reflecting on just the shitty day you had, and yeah, it's not positive. Before you go to bed, a lot of times people will journal and just write. It doesn't have to be a journal. It can actually be like one piece of paper. This is what I want to do. This is what I want to accomplish. And what I'm thankful for today and what I'm looking for to tomorrow. Nighttime is a time to be thankful and look forward to tomorrow and to hope that tomorrow will come. Because for some of us, they may not. Speaking of your bedroom in general, as if your bedroom is filled with crap, look around the room. Like go and jump on your bed and look around your room. Do not have rooms that are not used. That's where energy just gets clogged. It gets stuck. You want to have clean rooms. Every room should be clean, should be organized. So when you walk through, the rooms feel light. Everybody has those rooms that you walk in and just feel heavy. Like it's just a room that you throw shit in and you don't really care about. Yeah, and with that goes your energy. That's where energy gets stuck. And this also includes things like cobwebs in the corner, cracked frames, lamps that just don't work. I've been in many homes that I go to turn on a light switch or like a, I'm not kidding, an entire hallway. And I'm hitting the switches and I come to find out they're like, oh yeah, those bulbs broke a long time ago, but I don't have time to get a ladder and replace a bulb. Okay, to each their own. But again, that's bringing darkness. You do not want darkness in your home, okay? You want darkness at night. In the daytime, you want light. And it's just funny. These are people like, oh, you know, these things have been broken since, you know, sophomore year. It's just like, no, please. You don't have an excuse. Everybody has time to replace a bulb. Or like if there's a rug that you just know is dirty, go get another one. I mean, we now have dollar stores. We have Home Goods. We have tons of places. Put the effort in. Put the effort in. It's your home. I mean, that's all I can't stop repeating that. It's your home. And don't hide stuff. A lot of people will pack stuff under your bed. Now, organize stuff under your bed, I get it. But to dump it and hide it and, you know, get rid of it, you know, the whole out of sight, out of mind does not work. I will be happy to send anyone a checklist. There are, well, actually, you could just Google them. Feng Shui, F-E-N-G-S-H-U-I. There are checklists that you can follow through basic stuff. But again, I don't feel there are feng shui professionals that go through your home and will tell you what you need to do and all this stuff. I've actually done it for quite a few people. I usually try, even when I'm there doing it, I will tell them, honestly, just stick to the whole concept of common sense. You want to be able to flow through your home and just feel it as if it's a place of peace. Start outside and walk in and around your home. And I usually recommend clockwise, but you're a stream of wind. You're a flow of water. Flowing and trying not to get stuck on crap. And this is also something you can easily, very easily. And I recommend this. If you have children, they're never too young to be taught about how to keep their room clean. And to feel good and not just clean the room because they must, because, you know, or else, and then a threat. I think that's stupid. When you're a kid and your parents made you do things, most of us just rebelled. This is not something that they should be, you know, don't teach them to do it because they have to. Explain to them why it works. It's a good approach. Create a story. They will be thankful as they grow up to not live in filth. A positive, you know, just something, a happy bedroom. A clean bedroom is a happy bedroom. Everything has a place and there's a place for everything. So, happy spring. Don't focus so much on making positive energy or chasing abundance. The positive energy flows around us already. Abundance is everywhere. It travels through your city and your town. It travels down the streets and avenues of your neighborhoods. So by keeping your home clean, You're welcoming it into your home. You're attracting it. You attract this energy. You don't have to chase it. This also goes for the power of the sun. Open your windows and let the warmth and healing power of the sun into your home and your heart. This was episode 115. Use this spring season to reset yourself out of hibernation, not just from winter, but all that has been keeping you from receiving abundance, good health, and positive energy. Be well all. Please visit my YouTube page and check out my Monday morning Mind's Eye meditations and my new subliminal sessions. And don't forget also my website, www.noemahh.com. And while you're there, check out my blog. I'm always adding new blogs. Thank you for everything. Happy spring.
Brought to you by Noema, Hypnosis and Healing and the Mind's Eye Meditation, and dedicated to all those that get up every day and hustle and do all they can to make a difference in their lives and the lives of others.